Yeah, I guess this video was just inevitable. So there's been a lot of talk going around about Star Wars. You know, the biggest franchise to ever grace the Earth with a fan base spanning and cultivating generations upon generations of its fandom. Spreading from family to family, friend to friend. I mean, let's just be real here. It's now commonplace for people to even dress up their neighborhood good boy as Chewbacca around Halloween time. A universe that created not only legacy characters within its own franchise, but created lifelong legacy cinema characters with Luke, Han Solo, Princess Leia, Anakin Skywalker, Obi-Wan, Yoda, Darth Vader, Chewbacca, Boba Fett, Ahsoka. Shit, even the droids have become household names. I mean, everyone knows who C-3PO and R2-D2 are. And it's unfortunate because I'm still probably missing quite a few. Star Wars was a franchise that transcended cinema with each and every installment, and while some did more than others, it was an experience to watch Star Wars. The interconnected stories, the characters that were spawned from it, and the world itself was simply something that we seem to be missing in our recent Hollywood entertainment. Star Wars became a franchise that was must-watch cinema. Rather, it became your family's favorite franchise to watch on the couch for movie nights, a movie that you were showing your girlfriend for the first time, or times that you just needed that good old nostalgia for great character writing and storytelling. Star Wars was always there for you. And that's the point, my fellow graders. Star Wars was an IP and a franchise that was destined for greatness 20 years before I was born, and... well, I'm not gonna lie. Until recently, I thought it was going to be that way forever. Enter in 2012. The year of so many notable events like Barack Obama being re-elected as president, the tragic event of Sandy Hook for all of you that live here in America, LeMickey James winning his second NBA championship for the Miami Heat, Coney 2012, and in a move that we never foresaw coming, George Lucas selling the rights to Star Wars to the Mickey Mouse himself. Fast forward to 2023. If you weren't living through it, you would find it shocking, honestly flabbergasting, if I told you that Star Wars as an IP is dead. Or dying, depending on how you look at the concept of death. But how are we even at this point? How did this happen? When did this happen? While all the answers have been in front of our face, take a walk with me, my dear graders, to the memory lane from Doctor Strange Mom as Disney Star Wars enters the chat. With the release of 5 movies in these last 11 years, including a new trilogy to complete the now-deemed Skywalker saga, reintroducing not only our old OT characters and reviving their characters back on the big screen, and let's be real here, that was enough. I mean, truly. But with that, then us the audience were given the idea of introducing a new female Force user, who we know can work very well after following the introduction of Ahsoka as a character in the animated Clone Wars show. As well as a new Force-sensitive ex-Stormtrooper that we've never seen on the big screen before, a whole new concept, and a new villain coming in the form of Han Solo and Leia's kid, trained by Luke Skywalker and fallen to the dark side of the Force. And while yes, at the time, it did look like a corny Darth Vader knockoff, the possibilities were truly endless with the trio of characters that I just laid out before you. As well as 2 more films showcasing the origins of one of the most legacy characters in not only the Star Wars universe, but cinema as a whole in Han Solo, and a film that quote-unquote is patching up one of the biggest plot holes to plague the original and the prequel series. As well as 5 Disney Plus shows again, showcasing the life of 2 legacy characters from the OT and the prequels with Obi-Wan Kenobi and Boba Fett. With one of the biggest merchandising characters to hit the big screen since that talking snowman from Frozen. With, again, I have to reiterate, 2 animated projects, you would think to yourself that Star Wars would be bigger than ever, bought by a company that could internally source any new idea, any new product, casting choices, and a prior fan base of Disney and Star Wars together all riding for it. It couldn't have been a bigger home run for Disney in the moment. So why isn't it? In what might be the biggest downfall, and honestly, in this case, it could be even worse, this is the biggest case of fan apathy that I have ever witnessed in my life. From the terrible disaster of character writing that was in the sequel trilogy, to the blatant lies and eventual truth coming out of the pre-production hell it was internally at Disney when it came to the ideas and planning of the sequel trilogy, eventually admitting that they had no plan at all, flowing from director to director as if they're picking out their favorite cereal at the supermarket, and the cope from Disney that followed it all. Actors and actresses without already pre-established pedigrees outside of Star Wars can't find significant, or in some cases, any work at all.
What the fuck?
And the narrative shift into audience blaming and creating the narrative of toxic Star Wars fans.
Yeah.
Morons.
And while bad character writing happens all the time, Disney Star Wars wasn't the first culprit, and they certainly won't be the last. The character assassinations were a different case. Not many studios are blessed with the opportunity such as Disney back in 2012. The fan base was immense, fruitful, and dedicated to the entertainment that they held dear. And while most would see that as a blessed and easy money-making situation, for some reason, Disney thought quite the opposite. It started with the characters of Luke, Leia, and Han. I mean, shit, Harrison Ford more than likely saw the writing on the wall even at the time, so he dipped out after one film. A true disgrace, with the three OG characters never sharing the screen at the same time as each other. Really the easiest fan service in the book of fan service, but Disney was too big-headed at the time. It was the new characters for us, whether we liked it or not, and well, instead of utilizing some craft, grace, and creativity to maybe find a way to incorporate the old with the new, or in Disney's case, the new with the old, instead, the old Grim Reaper came for our characters, in some cases, belittled to a point of basically being neutered. Gone was the hopeful and optimistic Luke Skywalker, a character that could see the good side of a person who, at the time, was probably the second most evil person in the universe. Say hello to new Luke, a pathetic incel who chooses to give up his friends and family because he's scared. Ah, what an upgrade. Goodbye to the charming, charismatic, and quick-witted Han Solo. He is now a deeply sad, sorry, pathetic loser of a man who can't take care of his son and had a failing marriage. Another solid update in character writing. And goodbye to the confident and intelligent Jedi Master, Obi-Wan Kenobi. Say hello to Ben, the man who decided to give up his use of the Force, even though he is on a mission to protect his best friend's son from the evils of the universe. And while he won't be able to do that now with the Force, he now has a solid buff ability of crying.
Crap.
Sheer fucking hubris.
Leading us to, well, where we are now, 11 years later, from Star Wars to Disney Star Wars, where a baby Yoda, yes, I repeat, a puppet named Baby Yoda, Grogu to be in fact, is the only thing keeping the ship afloat. And when it comes to how accurate those ratings are, it doesn't really seem sustainable post The Mandalorian Season 3. There's not really a bunch of nostalgia-based characters to fall back on anymore with the character assassinations of Luke, Han, Obi-Wan, Vader, Boba Fett, and I assume Ahsoka whenever that show decides to ever come out, and the creativity in the studios of LucasFilms has to be damn near beneath the sea level of California with the amount of brain-dead activity. The products and the quote-unquote entertainment that we the fans and the audience have put up with and have been given over the past decade has been atrocious, and what might be finally some of the only good news that we've gotten out of Lucasfilm in the past couple years, I think they're finally starting to feel that effect. And while I don't think Star Wars can ever truly die, I do think their next move will either catch the attention of fans or kill Disney Star Wars forever. Thank you all for watching, and make sure you guys all like the video and subscribe to the channel to watch other videos such as this, as well as future content. Let me tell you, I do not want Star Wars to die. I don't want any great franchises to die. They don't deserve it. Like, I was able to watch Star Wars as a chicken, and I love Star Wars even now. And that's not really a thing that this new generation of chickens is able to do. It's pretty depressing when you actually sit down and think about the state of Disney Star Wars, really. But I guess that's why we're here. Make sure you guys comment down below how you guys feel about the state of Star Wars right now. And you know what? For shits and giggles, give me a top 5 list. Either the worst or the best out of Disney Star Wars. It doesn't matter. But it doesn't always have to be slander around here. But otherwise, that's all the words I got for you today. Bye.